This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your guest host, Kelly Chase. Whitley will be back in the captain's chair next week. Today, I have the pleasure of speaking to Robin Lassiter. Robin is the author of the phenomenal book, Earth, A Love Story, and is the host of a podcast by the same name. She's also a lifelong experiencer and the community manager for the Experiencer Group. What I appreciate so much about Robin is her thoughtfulness and insight into the most deeply human parts of what it means to be an experiencer, and her courageousness in speaking about some of the darker and more complicated aspects as well. Her ability to think and feel deeply into these shadowy realms makes her an invaluable voice in this community. I've linked to Robin's work and to the Experiencer Group in the episode description so you could check them out. Without further ado, here's my conversation with Robin Lassiter.
Hi, Robin. Welcome to Dreamland. It's so great to have you.
Hi, Kelly. Thank you so much. It's wonderful to be here. Thanks for having me.
Oh, absolutely. Something I love about doing this work is that I feel like I get to catch up with friends and people I want to talk to, and I get to technically work. So it's always a fun opportunity. And you and I have just been ships passing in the night this last year, and it's great to get some time to actually sit down and chat with you.
Yeah, I feel the same way. It's wonderful. And I have a podcast as well, and that's the best part of it. Yeah, is catching up with people that I really want to talk to. So it's great to see you. Great to be here.
Oh, so wonderful. So I'd love to start. I'm a huge fan of your book, Earth, A Love Story. And there was something in the preface that really stood out to me, and something that really resonated with me that felt like a great place to start our conversation. And if it's okay with you, I'm just going to read just a couple lines from that.
Amazing.
It says, this is a true story. I'm not going to tell it the way it happened. I don't have a high perch where I looked down from above and watched it all play out, noting this and that, keeping track of how that thing wove into this thing and seeing clearly what it all meant. No, I'm telling it the way I remember it, the way I experienced it down here, deep, deep down in through my body, my most intimate relationship with life, looking out through my eyes. I thought that was so beautifully written, and it resonated with me so deeply, and it spoke to this problem that I think that we as experiencers run into all the time when we're trying to relate these stories, which is that it's really difficult to put words to these things. And that all of us, experiencer or not, I think have a really complex relationship with our own memories and kind of the labyrinth that they create. And I think experiencers have a way of having to grapple with that in a different way, because we're trying to convey something so deeply personal and so integral. I would love to just hear like your thoughts on that. Like, how did you go about starting to write a book about these things that are so entirely hard to describe and hard to name?
Yeah, thank you so much. It's always a treasure when somebody reads an author's writing back to them. So thank you. I felt very compelled to write the book, and that's a nice way to put it. I felt sort of badgered and pressured, which I thought was strange. A strange thing for these beings that I had been in contact with to ask me to do. I was like, really, you want me to write a book? That's what all this is about. But that was the reason that I wrote it. I did not want to write this book. I did it kicking and screaming. And I started this book a few times from a very removed, distant stance where I could perhaps describe things in an objective way and convince someone of its reality, right? Because it was terrifying to unleash all of this that was within me. And what I found was that I couldn't tell the story that way. I had to actually get as close to the experiences and as close to the story as I possibly could. And in doing that, it was just a giant leap of faith and an act of courage to tell it that way. And in doing that, I knew that there were things that I could never convince anyone of or convey. It had to be as close to the experience as possible through my eyes, through my body, through the sensations, as absurd as some of it was, as unbelievable as much of it was, the only way that I could convey it was to tell it as truthfully as I could from my own experience. And talking about memory and the sort of murkiness of a lot of these experiences, I also knew, this is strange, but I've been thinking about this. I knew that as I wrote it down, like as I made it concrete by telling the story and telling it in a particular way, that that would become larger than the memory. You know, I had kept all of these things inside of myself for so long, and they, my only reference was that. And then putting it out into the world, it's like, oh, this is going to be the story now. And there are more nuances and there are different ways I could have told it, but it was sort of like locking it into this particular story. And it is very subjective and it is mysterious, and it's hard to pin down exactly from the external what's going on. So I knew I had to tell it as close to my own experience as possible.
Oh, I really do identify with that. I think I've only kind of told pieces of my own story, but I've had that same sense of like that in some ways I was solidifying this thing that had been kind of nebulous, and that naturally it even has changed in some ways the way that I remember it. And I wonder if there isn't a little bit of magic in that. You know, there's been kind of a lot of evidence, you know, scientific evidence that's come out, you know, in previous years about retrocausality and that sort of thing. And it almost feels like writing the past as much as it feels like remembering the past. And I think that can be really powerful when you get to choose, you know, how you interpret it.
1,000,000%. One of the phrases I use in the book is that I story tell myself into being. It's like the narrative happened, right? And also I could have chosen a different one and highlighted more things more heavily. But this narrative, this storytelling that I did made sense of my life. And it did not make sense before I put this story together. And so that really resonates and makes a lot of sense to me. And yeah, there is a kind of magic in that, especially if, I don't know what your experiences have been like, but mine, that I've been like really kind of pressured to be public about things and to tell a story. There is kind of like, this is the thing. This is the way that this story is going to be told. And then it does feel like as much of a piece of the puzzle as anything else. It's wild. Yeah.
I love that. So for people who might not be familiar with you or your work, could you talk a little bit about your background and kind of how you came to identify as an experiencer?
Yeah, thank you. It's a very long story.
Take it long or as short as you'd like.
Okay. So I'm a lifelong experiencer. I had some of my first memories are of being kind of taken, you know, leaving my body, leaving the bedroom, leaving the house, and then seeing it all from a height and feeling often a sense of terror, feeling presences near me, being shown what I called my Armageddon dreams. Even though our family was not religious in any way, there wasn't that lore in my household growing up. But I was shown these images of destruction over and over. And then throughout much of my life had a huge variety of experiences, mystical experiences, prophetic dreams, visitations from beings, lots of out-of-body experiences, lots of altered states. And I had absolutely no way to categorize it or make sense of it or understand it. And for a certain period of my childhood, I assumed this was just life. Like everybody had these experiences and then realized at some point, oh, you don't talk about this stuff. In fact, I have a really good friend we met in junior high, and just in the last year, she found my book. I often joke that like, I didn't write my book for people that I know. I wrote it for strangers. Like it's very intimate and it's very vulnerable. It's like, I don't want all these people that I know to read it, but she found it and she reached out to me and she said, I remember this. I remember you talking about these experiences as, you know, I would have been like 11 or something, 10 or 11. And that was so precious to me. I was so grateful for that because it was this external confirmation. So I had kind of waves of these experiences throughout my life. They would go quiet for a while and then it would start up again. Most of them for a long time, I would categorize as terrifying. There was a lot of terror. There was a lot of trauma. There was a lot of confusion. I couldn't find any explanation. I couldn't find any help. And it wasn't until late 2019 when I heard my first, I get the date wrong sometimes, I apologize. I think it was late 2020 when I first heard Stuart Davis's Aliens and Artists podcast. And it was like, I had to listen to it in chunks and a little bit at a time because I would have these huge physical reactions and waves of terror and disbelief and this can't be actually true and I can't believe other people have these experiences. Until then, I didn't know ufology existed. I'd never heard of the word experiencer. I didn't have any context or framework for it. And the thing that really transformed my life and helped me tell this story about myself was hearing other people talk about it, hearing experiences, and also being given this really sophisticated framework from people like Stuart Davis. I still remember very clearly hearing our mutual friend, Jake Christopher King, talk about his experiences. I can recall it because I was crying and driving and listening to him go into great detail about all of this. People like Mike Cleland, people who helped me put a framework together so that I could start believing myself and my own experiences. And it helped me to not feel crazy. And it gave me an anchor in the world that I really had never had. So that's the very, very short version of how, of how I got here. Yeah.
I love that. And I really resonate with that as well. I think that there is this perception in the kind of greater consensus reality about experiencers that we are overly credulous or that like we can't tell the difference between, a bad dream and something that actually happened or that we don't ever question ourselves. And I think that experiencers end up questioning themselves and their reality and their history and their memory more than just about anyone. And that you can kind of like spiral out and lose yourself because you get to a place where you can't even trust yourself anymore. And when you find other people who are saying these unnameable things that you thought no one else understood, it like grounds you back into yourself in a way that's so powerful. And I have such a big place in my heart, and I know you do too, for people who still don't have that framework and are out there just kind of alone in this and how isolating that can be.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I'm going to praise you a little bit, but your podcast, UFO Rabbit Hole podcast is so incredibly helpful for that because it builds a bridge for people who it's very terrifying to move from for many of us, for me, even though I grew up with all these experiences, I've had them my whole life. I'm very connected to nature. I'm not like I'm an artist and a writer and I'm not super anchored in consensus reality anyway, but I needed that as well. I needed like a bridge from rational materialism kind of through science consciousness to get to this point. And you give that to people in such a profound way. And I know many people that I've spoken to have talked about your work being really vital for that. And yes, most experiencers I know, including myself, describe themselves as skeptics. Like we don't know what's going on. And as soon as we think we do, there will be an experience that blows that up, And so it's very tender and vulnerable to approach the fact that this might actually be as real or more real than what we're told reality is, because it changes everything. It absolutely changes everything. And so a lot of my work has been like, how do we cross that threshold safely, slowly without edging into places that are dangerous psychologically? Like it's real. The danger is real in those areas. Yeah. As we try to figure all of this out.
Absolutely. And thank you so much, Robin. That's so sweet of you to say. You know, you mentioned in there that you feel like you kind of exist outside of consensus reality. And that's sort of this like parallel and integrated story in your book. Can you talk a little bit about like how your life, you know, kind of caused you to sort of be brought up in this space that's sort of outside of consensus reality and how that has contributed to all of this for you?
Yeah, I think in the book I say, you know, taking into account the idea that we in some way have a pre-incarnational plan or something like that, that it's like, I agreed to come here if I get to come here this way. And what that meant for me was I had this very idyllic childhood. I grew up in a valley in the middle of nowhere, and the nearest neighbor was like a mile and a half away if you climbed up and over the ridge, you know. And we had horses and chickens, and my parents were back to the lander hippies, and I grew up in a dome. There was no television. There was no radio. For a long time, there was no electricity. And it created this very close connection with sort of the natural rhythms and also the experience of nature that wasn't kind of modulated through Disney or something, although it was later, like we got TV, you know, we did come into the world at some point, but for a long time it was like, oh, that hillside over there feels slightly dangerous. It feels wilder than other places. And you kind of skirt around it because you can feel that there's some presence there. And that was absolutely normal and part of life. And growing up here and then coming into the world was a huge shock to my system. It was a massive trauma, and it was confusing, and I didn't know how to be in the world or what everybody was, we were doing. You know, I went to college and I was just like, what are we all doing? Is this it? Is this what we're doing? Okay. And how do I do it? And I tried, and I was just this incredibly, I still am just an incredibly sensitive human being. Everything hits me hard. And so part of my story as well is that I started numbing at a really early age with alcohol and other drugs. And that became part of my story for a long time. And so that in itself, like addiction itself, puts you outside of society a little bit, like outside of the normal, quote unquote, normal, whatever that is, realm, because they're altered states, because there are, it's this very internal, alive landscape that's very difficult to describe to people. And it's not socially acceptable. And so it's another layer of kind of being outside of kind of what everybody else is doing. And so pretty quickly, I quit college. I joined a commune. I've moved 32 times in my life. Like it took me a long time to try to figure out how to be in the world for this like confluence of things, which was these experiences that I can't explain and addiction and feeling very, very unsafe in my body. You know, I have a theory that like, you know, I'm 45 years old. There's a group of us, I think, that came into the world and then experienced young adulthood or, you know, young teen years in the 90s, which was just this wild time where they're like, nobody knew about consent and all these things. So it was much easier for me to be dissociated, much easier for me to stay on the fringes of the world. You know, everybody else was like getting their 4-year degree and having kids and, you know, starting families. And I was, you know, swimming in the ocean and living in a commune and taking this other path that there wasn't a lot of support or like affection for people. You know, nobody looked and was like, oh, you're doing great. You know, it's like, no, your life is wild and weird and we don't get it. And I kept trying to have a normal life and it just never worked for me.
We'll be right back after this quick break. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
Well, now it's my chance to compliment you. Something I appreciate so much about your work is how courageous and open you are in talking about addiction and its correlation to anomalous experience, because I think so many experiencers find themselves somewhere along that spectrum between addiction and recovery. As a result of these experiences, you know, the isolation and dissociation that you were talking about, and, just trying to numb things and trying to get away from harsh realities and that sort of thing. And I appreciate so much that you talk about that, because I think that the stigma of it all is enough to deal with. And I think people are afraid for a million reasons of wanting to be believed and, you know, wanted to be taken seriously. And so thank you for being so willing to talk about that, because it's so needed. And I really appreciate that you do that.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's interesting as you're saying that it did take a tremendous amount of courage. And this is one of the places that I went like kicking and screaming, you know, because the directive that I got was like, talk about the trauma, talk about the, you know, relationship trauma, talk about the experiences. And addiction, I was like, absolutely not. I absolutely will not talk about these things. And there's a part of the book that actually, I sort of wrote the book and I was telling my backstory, and then it caught up to my present life. And so this last like third of the book or something is written real time as these experiences were happening. And they, you know, I was pushed. It kept getting louder. The call kept getting louder. Things kept getting weirder. I kept having more disturbing experiences. And all of it was to write a book, and to tell this particular story. And it was so, again, so absurd, so confusing. Like, why? What is important about this? Eventually I surrendered. But I didn't want to talk about any of it. It's all, you know, and then my experience with eventually getting sober. Before I got sober, I would listen to people tell their sobriety and recovery journeys on podcasts or whatever. And I noticed that it was like the darker their story, if they survived it and came through, they became these lights in the world and they helped people and their life became about service. And those stories of that turn of how it can be so dark and so bad and horrible, like truly like hell realms, you know, the depths of my addiction right before I got sober was a hell realm. It was hell. And hearing other people talk about that and being like, it's possible to get through. It's possible like in 5 years, even to laugh about it and be like, tell war stories and stuff and be like, that insane thing happened and I survived it, saved me. You know, they were like this like little lifeline that like, it's possible to get through this. And so I also feel a responsibility and a joyful obligation to say it so that it could help other people along that path. I think like addicts and experiencers and, you know, people who've had a lot of trauma are, I used to call them like sleeper agent angels. Because if we survive it, if we make it through, we've seen the depths, we've seen the darkness, and we're not afraid of it. Like, I'm not afraid of anybody's grief. I'm not afraid of like the darkest story that somebody's been through or an experience of, you know, being visited by something that caused absolute terror. Like, I've seen it and I'm not afraid of it. And I also know there's a, like a path through, and that's, I would never trade any of it just for that purpose. Yeah.
That's wonderful. I think that something I love about your book so much is the way that it captures this real dichotomy and tension that exists within these kinds of experiences, where you've encountered beings that are, I think many people would identify as alien, right? Mm-hmm. And yet your book is called Earth, a Love Story, you know, you talk about trauma so beautifully and how it can be turned into this like deep well of like healing and compassion for other people and you know, encountering these things that are so, these intelligences that are so profoundly different makes us kind of discover ourselves. And I think that's, for me, I think you just capture that so well, and it's so hard to talk about.
Yeah, thank you so much. I feel really seen. I got a little emotional, like when you, as you relate that. Thank you. That was what happened for me. It's like, oh, we're not alone. This isn't a sterile landscape. You know, it's actually a very full ecosystem that is full of all of these unseen beings of, and this is my worldview of like all different varieties. I don't think the phenomenon is one thing. I think it's like the dead and NHI, non-human intelligence of all kinds. And when I received that framework, which I think came from Sean S. Bjorn Hargens, I think I was listening to a podcast of his and it was like, oh, it's all of it. And that made so much sense to me, and it really clicked in, and it helped me make sense of my experiences. And in relation to that, in relation to the realization that it's this full ecosystem, it gave me this sense of identity as humanity, as a species that is similar in some ways and separate in some ways than all of this other really rich, full ecosystem. And because many of us have become quite disconnected from nature just because of modernity in the modern world, we don't have that same sort of reflection from nature to say, there's this, and then there's us, and then sort of the other gives us our identity. This otherness helps us understand our own identity. And when I had that realization, I saw humanity in a completely different light, and not negating any of the horrible darkness, the bad things that we do, the ways that we're still asleep, the ways that we are unconscious of a lot of the trauma that we create for ourselves and for others. I saw us as really extraordinary beings, and that we are creators and we have all of this potential, and that we, for the most part, I would say, unless we are lost in hell realms, right? Because that was my experience as well. Like, I've been lost in a hell realm. I know how selfish I was and how only centered on myself I became and all of those things. And so unless we're lost in hell realms, what our innate desire is towards goodness, towards taking care of each other, towards being in connection with the planet. And I feel like that's actually our natural state. And I was shown all of that in response to the realization that we're part of this enormous ecosystem. And I think that this is something I haven't talked about very much, but I think humanity has like a self-esteem problem, you know, that we feel like we're kind of blights on the planet or that we're a cancer on the planet. And like, yes, we're doing some stuff that's really disconnected from kind of our natural state and the way that we have the potential to be. And also we are extraordinary. We're as divine as any other creation or creature. And so coming to terms with that, forgiving myself for being in those states, understanding it was because of trauma, and then choosing, like having a secure enough nervous system to choose to do things differently. It's like, we can be this other thing too, you know, to the best of our ability, and it's going to be messy and we're going to screw up, but we do have enormous potential as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I wonder, in some of the ways you talk about, you know, how this book kind of almost made you write it and that sort of thing. I wonder if you resonate with this. Over the last, you know, year or so, I've really come to think of creativity as both a kind of contact and also a kind of affirmation of our divinity, that there's something really magical in that. And I wonder if that resonates with you.
I really love that. I think that that's such a great question and a great realization. Yeah. It's, there's something there, right? And it's, my sense as I'm thinking about it is it's hard to see. It's hard for me to see right now because most of what I see and consume is through my screen. And there's so much content and creativity is, I don't know, there's so much that feels like it belongs to the machine of the world. It's like we create and the world eats it and we create and the world eats it, you know? And so to me, it's a little hard to see. And also when I do come across something that feels truly inspired and feels like it is from this mysterious connection that we have to something bigger than ourselves or something deep in ourselves or something along those lines, it's unmistakable, you know? Like our bodies respond. That's been a huge part of my journey too. Like the body responds. We get chills or we get emotional or something happens when we're touched by that, either as the creator or as the kind of consumer of creativity and seeing other people's creative work. So yeah, I really love that. I do think that that's it. I think that that's one of the, and I first heard this again from Stuart Davis. He really kind of was a mentor of mine. And he said, that is our primordial lineage, like the primordial lineage of humanity is creativity. And that makes a lot of sense to me. And it's special, you know, it's, yeah, it feels important.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I think there's something I've discovered so much of this with contact, like forces the kind of surrender. And I see that with creativity as well, you know, that I'm always trying to like fight this thing into what I want it to be, but that it ultimately kind of ends up being what it wants to be. And that at a certain point, it almost feels like a plant that's like reaching, like growing towards a light. And I might not be able to see the light, but this work of art is suddenly like moving towards something and ends up being better than the thing I had imagined. And it's, I'm very struck by that, that there's this kind of way through creativity that we end up being better than we are. And I'm always really fascinated by that.
I absolutely love that. I couldn't say it better. And it's a beautiful image of creativity, like that it is, you know, maybe ontologically whole, and we're like guiding, shaping, we're in relationship to it. It's not ours that we're forcing into something, but that it's a relationship that's occurring. Yeah, I really love that.
Yeah. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, you know, obviously you do a lot of work with the Experiencer Group, which is a really, you know, beautiful community. What has that been like for you, kind of both finding community and then, you know, being in service to that community?
Yeah, thank you so much. I was there on when the doors opened, which is amazing. You know, I kind of came into that space when there was nothing there yet. And it was this small community, and the relief that I felt of being in a space where people were saying these things that I have said and want to say, and nobody was batting an eye. Nobody was like, saying, well, are you sure it wasn't a, you know, it's just this space of pure total acceptance and support. And I mean, it was absolutely life-changing. It was like, oh, I found my people. There you all are. Where, you know, I had looked for them in kind of the like new age, areas and in religion and in, you know, even like starseed communities and things like that. And it's this particular community that holds this particular like framework and understanding of these experiences where I found safety. I found safety. And I often joke, like, you know, the first 6 months or so, I would attend support group meetings and I would sweat through my clothes and cry. Like that was my move every time, you know, just as I tried to speak and it wouldn't come through my throat and then my hands were shaking and my body was shaking and, you know, can I really say this thing and have it be met with just utter acceptance, you know, was very extraordinary. And it really, I mean, I see my life. One of the things that these beings that I work with showed me was these two big blocks of my life and that the book would bridge the gap between these two big blocks of my life. And as I was writing the book, I was in the experiencer group. And so I also, there's like a before and an after. And I've never felt so understood, so held, so seen. And, you know, lifelong friends. And it's a beautiful, powerful place. And I'm honored to serve that community. I have, I worked on the back end of that community for a while, vetting new members and, doing some admin stuff and, facilitated groups of different varieties. And now I facilitate a women's group, which is very important, around the subject of, you know, things that are really difficult to talk about that we still have a hard time coming to terms with, like the parts of experiences that have to do with reproduction, reproductive issues. And I also facilitate, we call it a non, let's see, you're gonna have to edit out me saying it incorrectly. Anomalous Anonymous. So that's our kind of AA support meeting, which is not for, you know, there's no push to get people into recovery. There's no ideology around like you have to be sober or anything like that. It's just like, how does the experience of addiction or use of substances of any and all kind, what is the confluence of that and experience? You know, people talk about sometimes, you know, which was my experience at times, like if I drank a lot, I could stop the experiences, you know, or if I am kind of numbing out too much, they stop. And now if I want to have more experiences or more contact because my relationship with it has changed, then I can notice the things that I'm doing with substances that may help that or not, even as, you know, small as caffeine or something like that. So that's that group. And it's amazing. And it's been a few years and there's never a meeting that I go into that I don't come out of feeling just incredibly grateful to be with a group of people who can share their stories in a safe space like that. So I cannot say enough about the experiencer group. It's been extraordinary.
It really is. I want to drill down a little more into something you mentioned, you know, with the women's group. I you know, at Contact in the Desert this year, our friend J. Christopher King led a panel of experiencers. And a question he asked that about made me fall out of my chair, but also I was like, yes, that's my friend. you know, was he asked, do you think, you know, he asked of the women, like, do you think that the kind of the way that we refuse to grapple with the topic of hybridization, you know, within the larger UFO community, like, do you think that's a result of the de-emphasis of the stories of women? And I was like, wow, it like took my breath away. And I do, you know, I'm not somebody who has personal experience with that. And so I almost felt ashamed that I hadn't recognized that beforehand, but that there is this, you know, but I am someone who has been the victim of sexual violence. And so I understand the very particular, not that men can't be victims of that as well, but because of the issue of reproduction and everything that goes along with that, it becomes like a different kind of a violation for a woman that I think can be hard for people to understand. But I think that, I guess I'd love to hear your thoughts on like, what are we missing by kind of ignoring that piece of the puzzle? Because it seems like it's very, very significant that we have more than enough evidence that this is something that's been going on a large scale for quite some time now. But it's a part of the narrative that people seem just completely unwilling to integrate into the conversation.
We'll be right back after this quick break.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you for sharing that question that Jay asked. I'm also sort of stunned by it. I got chills, you know, when you reported that. It's a great question. And also I'll say that we have like mixed gender groups that talk about these things as well. Men are absolutely have experienced being part of the hybrid program, having their own experiences with that. It's such a big question. I think it's so difficult to wrap our heads around, you know, that this could actually be happening even to the people that it's happening to. You know, it took me a very long time to fully admit and come to terms with the fact that this is part of my experience and has been. The first time that I kind of started to understand that it could be a possibility, I'd shelved it. I just put it on the shelf and I thought, I can't, it's too much. I cannot process this at all. And I think that, I think one of the things we're missing in this is the grief, you know, there's, it's really hard to approach grief in all forms. And one of the things that I think makes this really hard to talk about is first the stigma, you know, the unbelievability, the confusing aspect of it, the fact that it, you know, as we listen to people's stories around this, yes, physical bodies are taken. Yes, astral bodies are taken. Like, it also happens in that space. It's very confusing. It's very hard to, you know, as all of the phenomenon, it's just very hard to pin down into a simple answer. And it has to do with things that we keep very private, you know? And then the for women in particular, like the loss of pregnancies or, you know, experiences that happened, like my experience happened when I was way too young. And, you know, there is overlap absolutely between, you know, sexual assault, sexual violence, and it is a violation. And these things are just hard to talk about in general. And then you put on top of that, the sort of unbelievability or, you know, the stigma that has in some ways been intentionally magnified on this, and it becomes just incredibly difficult to talk about. And underneath all of that, I think, is a lot of grief. And so having, again, safe spaces to express these things and be held in a group where, you know, people understand what we're talking about, to me has been one of the most healing and profound things. And also there's shame associated with this stuff. So to answer the question, like, what are we missing? It's very human things that we're missing, which is, you know, the ability to go into these vulnerable spaces, the ability, you know, baseline to believe people about sexual assault, to believe women about violation. Like, that's deep in our culture that we're starting to come to terms with and reckon with, that to see how intrinsic it is to not believe it. And we're starting to get better about that, but it's still there, you know, that there's a lot of layers on top of this experience itself. So anytime anybody talks about it, I am very, very grateful. And that's why I chose to talk about it. Just nobody's obligated to talk about their experiences, right? Like, I'm not pushing anybody to be public or anything like that. Because I have been kind of pushed to be public, I feel like I only am able to come to terms with this because other people have talked about it. So I'm going to talk about it. You know, it's kind of like the least I can do.
Yeah. Well, and thank you. Thank you for your bravery in doing that. And also for pointing out, you know, because I don't want to smooth over that, but, you know, that men do experience this as well. But I know for myself with kind of sexual trauma that it's something that I have generally found to be more comfortable processing with women than with men. Not that, but men are absolutely processing, I'm sure, the same grief and the same violation and the same sadness around that. So thank you for making that clear, because I don't think I did. You know, I really liked what you said about, you know, that we're ignoring the human part of this, because I think that that's an opinion that you and I really share. And what can be so frustrating about kind of this like disclosure, like political intrigue, military cover-up, like that kind of paradigm, is that like the human part of this has just been completely wiped out. And I wonder if you can talk a little bit about what it's like for experiencers to kind of confront this narrative that seems so far divorced from, you know, the experiences that they're having in their actual lives.
Yeah, it's such a great question. It's and it's something I had to come to terms with. You know, I think a year and a half ago when the David Grush testimony came out, and I remember feeling a mix of things, right? Like, I can see that this is a path and a bridge for many people to be able to, and I've heard so many people who have not had experiences, or have not, you know, I think most of us have had some kind of experience, even like precognitive dream or lucid dream or something like that. But I've heard so many people say it was because of the 2017 article from Ralph Blumenthal and Leslie Kane that I started to even think that this reality was possible, or it was because of the congressional hearings, or, you know. And so I do think it's an important sort of like thread and narrative that's happening. I personally don't, I'm curious, like, it's interesting. I watch it, you know, and I'm like, yeah, I mean, there's mysteries there about crash retrievals, about, you know, reverse engineering technology, like all of that is very fascinating and is like a facet to this for sure. But experiencers themselves, I can't speak for. What I can say for myself is like, I don't care very much. I hate to say it that bluntly, but it still exists very much in the, you know, what I call the overculture, which is just the rational materialist framework that does not take experience seriously, period. You know, we're not like, dreams are the brain like recycling garbage or something and don't have any deeper meaning. And a lot of people who haven't seen outside of that paradigm assume that this is all imagination or it's dreaming or something like that. And for those of us who've had these experiences, we know that that's not the case. And also, I don't know how to make people understand that if they haven't had that experience. And so I find it sort of interesting and also kind of certainly frustrating. And also it feels like this massive paradigm shift is going to have to happen before people, I think we're moving towards taking experiencers' accounts seriously and understanding like that's the place to look to start to touch on the most interesting part of this, which is that, oh, reality isn't what we thought it was. Oh, consciousness is this great mystery that is absolutely interwoven into all of this. Oh, there is a mystery itself. We can't find the answers. We have to exist in the liminal. Oh, this may be a developmental driver. This may be even spiritual in nature. I think that experiencers go on that journey, and it's really difficult to ask people who are really entrenched in the current paradigm to do that. It's just a hard ask. So I feel like we're sort of set apart. Experiences are kind of still set apart, and we've already had disclosure, and so we're fine. So it's a mix of things. It's a mix of things. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, it makes me think the way that there's this kind of obsession with the tech, with the craft, you know, and yet so little talk about both the beings themselves and the human beings involved in all of this. And it makes me think of how, you know, like we were talking about before, that sometimes these, you know, confronting these anomalous experiences can start these processes of like denial and dissociation. And it almost feels like we're watching that at a cultural level, because we're, you know, people are being told, you know, that there is significant evidence of like a non-human presence on this earth, and they're like, yeah, but the craft, and like, and that's as far as the conversation seems to go. And it, I almost wonder if we're not, you know, there seems to be a parallel there when I look at it.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think one of the things that happened as part of my journey was that I, as I sort of came out of the experiencer closet, like as I started talking about these experiences with my family, the book helped tremendously. I mean, they understand me in a way that they didn't before. And so that was really helpful. But as I was kind of starting to talk about these things and not just keep them hidden, I would get frustrated that people didn't believe me or didn't understand or wouldn't take the journey. Or one of our favorites is like, I believe that you believe, which sounds like a kind thing to say, but it's also just like, okay, and that's fine. You know, so it's often the kind of the end of a conversation, which is okay. So I was frustrated with that. And I don't remember who gave me this piece of wisdom, but at some point I received this piece of wisdom that was, you know, like think about how hard it was for me, myself, who had the experiences to come to terms with this, and how in order for me to do that, I had to go through a process where my reality was kind of shattered and reassembled. And it wasn't reassembled as solidly as I left it. You know, it's like, I have to exist in the liminal and sort of develop the capacity to bear the face of the unknown, which is enormous. And that journey for me was, you know, very difficult, transformational, and I'm the one who had the experience. And so it gave me compassion for people who like haven't had the experience, and to realize that I think it's like maybe a self-protective kind of part of our psyche that like, I can only let this much in. I can only believe, I can only see this much, literally. I can't let the rest of it in because it will break my reality. And also like, I have to go to work and I have the kids to take care of. And I've got like all of the things that we're doing in the modern world just to try to survive. So absolutely understand the frustration and the pain that comes from people not understanding and not looking at like, it's this thing, like how can this not be the most interesting thing in the world to you? So I have compassion for that because I was given that framework, like, oh, you know, this will change everything. And we can only come to it as we can come to it.
Yeah, it really is hard sometimes to accept that kind of everyone has their own path. And it can be even hard for me to accept it, which is kind of hypocritical because like, I've only really accepted it in the last 3 years. And so a version of me that would have taken none of this seriously is not so far removed that I can't remember her very, very clearly. Mm-hmm. And so, but it still can be frustrating because I mean, I'll preface this by saying I give all of my friends and family a gold star for how they have all done their very best to meet me where I am in a place that is very different and that I've become a person who's very different than I was before. But at the same time, there is this kind of wall that goes up when mm-hmm. you recognize that someone who has always trusted and believed you now has this kind of like gap that they can't cross, that they, and that can be painful, and it's not their fault that they can't go there, but it can hurt. You feel like there's a loss there. There's something to grieve in a lot of relationships where suddenly, you know, they just can't go where you are, and that's okay, but it doesn't mean it doesn't hurt.
100%. Yeah. There is absolutely a loss there, and there's grief there. And I think that's something that we hear in the experiencer group often, is that struggle of like, my spouse is supportive. They understand that this is meaningful to me, but they don't understand it. And they don't want to, frankly, like why are they not obsessed? Why are they not listening to every podcast they can get their hands on? Why are they not looking at the evidence? Why are they not going on this journey? And it is painful. It is. That is a big part of the grief. And that's, you know, I think that one of the ways that we make it through this is by finding our people, like finding people who can hold that space with us. And there still is loss, that it's not, you know, it can't be all of our people, you know, our closest people. And to help us bear that, finding other people has just been like nothing I've ever had in my life, you know, is that level of understanding. And anybody who's spent time in person with other experiencers, like at a conference, or knows that feeling of just like, ah, like all the walls can come down and I can just be seen and held in exactly this space. And not only are people not like kind of silently, covertly rolling their eyes, but they're also leaning in, you know, like, oh, tell me, like, but then what? No, wait, don't skip that part. Like, I want to hear, you know, every detail. It's so healing to be in that space. Yeah. And yes, absolutely loss and grief with the people who can't meet us there. Yeah.
What would you recommend if someone is stumbling across this podcast and they're listening to this conversation and they're very kind of early in their own journey of kind of recognizing and integrating these things in their own life? What would you recommend to them?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's a huge part of it, is finding community, finding safe community, I feel like I was so lucky because I didn't know that for years, like ufology maybe fought with like the cryptid people or the fae people. And like, there were all these sort of separate areas of the phenomenon that didn't coexist. I feel so lucky that I was able to come into a place where it's like, no, it's all here. We can talk about all of it. And that was very helpful for me. And so finding podcast conversations, people who are talking about these things in a way that resonates. And my experience and hearing from many, many experiences is like, you know, when you find it, because again, the body has this big reaction of like, oh my God, I can't believe this is being said, or I can't believe this is being expressed, and I've never heard it, and this is my story. And so trusting that resonance, you know, trusting that there's something there. Something that was really, really helpful for me as well was I heard, I believe, again, it was Sean Esbjorn Hargens, but he said, what if we just start by believing people? And how I immediately translated that was to myself. Like, what if I just believe myself? Like, I had that experience. And take this journey, sometimes it needs to be slow and careful, but take the journey of like, am I crazy? These things I compartmentalized, can I bring them into my reality? Can I incorporate them in my overall reality? That was enormous for me, you know, just trusting ourselves, trusting the experience itself, even if we can't say what it means or what the broader context is, but like, I know I experienced this. And it's this building of like self-confidence and self-knowledge, and self-trust, and then finding community to support that. And then eventually for me, it was finding spiritual community that had space for all of this was incredibly important. Yeah, to me, it's all relational, like relationship with self, relationship with others is what got me through.
That's beautiful. And I think it's a great place for us to leave it for the public portion of the podcast. For any members of Dreamland, we will be continuing on for about another 20 to 30 minutes. For everyone else, thank you so much for being here. If you'd like to hear the rest of that conversation, you can sign up at unknowncountry.com.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.